So now I'm going to hand over shortly to Anna. Anna van Gon studied chemistry at University of Salerno in Italy and received her MSc in 2009. She then joined the doctoral program in bioinformatics at the University of Salerno, and she worked then as a visiting PhD student at the University of Oxford, obtaining her PhD in 2013. She then made a few visits to the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology in Saudi Arabia as an invited scientist, and she joined the Computational Structural Biology Group at Utrecht University as a postdoc researcher. In 2015, she obtained a Marie Curie Fellowship that supported her research at Utrecht since October 2015. Her research interests are focused on the study of protein-protein interactions, characterization and analysis of biological complexes by computational modeling, and docking in particular. Her work has resulted in 15 peer-reviewed publications and several international conference invitations. So, without further ado, I would now like to hand over to Anna. So, Anna, I will make you the presenter, and you can take it from there.
Okay. Thank you for the nice introduction, Adam. So today I'm going to talk about prediction of binding affinity in protein-protein complexes, and I'm going to give a brief demo about a web server related to the prediction of binding affinity that we lately developed. Okay, so the presentation will be divided in four parts. I will give an introduction, a general introduction about the binding affinity problem and the computational approaches that have been used so far to address the prediction of the binding affinity. I'm going to give some tips about the method that we developed to predict the binding affinity. I'm going to show results that will report I will show you the performance of our novel approach. And inside this part, I will also give a brief demo about our web server, and I will conclude. So, interaction between proteins. They are fundamental. Almost every function that taking place in an organism is regulated by interaction between proteins. For example, processes such as DNA replication, immune response, signaling cascade, and many more are consequences of interaction networks between proteins. Now, since those interactions also trigger the functions, perturbation in such networks are also often a cause of disease. Today I'm going to focus on one of the main properties of protein-protein complexes, which is the binding affinity. The binding affinity, or in other words, the binding free energy, it can be easily defined as the difference in energy between the bound form, that is the complex, and the free form, that is basically the two unbound, the two separate proteins. The difference of energetics of those two will define the binding free energy of the complex. This is a very interesting property because it gives us the idea of what is the binding strength of the complex and if actually this interaction will happen. Predicting the binding affinity can also be very interesting because it opened the way to study protein-protein complexes, to engineer new interactions and many other applications. So for this reason, prediction of the binding affinity has been a long-standing challenge. Now, the computational method that have been used so far to predict the binding affinity can be grouped in three main families. We have exact methods, for example, molecular dynamic approaches, which are very accurate because they try to sample the energetic landscape, the conformational landscape. But because of that, they can be very accurate, but they can also be very slow. And in the case of protein-protein complexes, we are talking about very big systems. So these kind of approaches might actually not be applicable on large scale. There have been also some different approaches within this exact method that can be used to speed up the calculation, as for example, umbrella sampling. But still, those are not methods that are considered for a large-scale prediction of binding affinities. On the other side, there are empirical scoring functions. So it's another family of approaches that can be used to predict the binding affinity. They are definitely faster, but they are also inaccurate because those kind of approaches are based on approximation. So since it's really time-consuming to describe the exact energy that keeps the two proteins together, those kind of approaches use approximation. So they try to describe these energetics using, for example, electrostatic interaction, van der Waals, exclusion of solvents, and many more other terms. But because of the approximation, this can lead to errors. Beside those two families, there is also another, let's say, family of approaches that can be used, and those are the structural properties. I'm going into the details of this. So structural properties, they have been used already in 40 years ago, in which basically there is attempt of correlate the structural property of protein-protein complex with the binding strength. The first structural property that was used in this context was the varied surface area. That is the surface that is varied from the solvent when the two proteins bind to each other. So in this figure is the one that you can see here in yellow. So it has been shown that the varied surface area somehow correlate with the binding affinity. So the broader is this surface, the stronger is the binding, which kind of makes sense. Although this property can be a descriptor of the binding affinity, but has not very high performance in case of prediction. A step forward to this varied surface area was made a couple of years ago in the group where I'm working now from a PhD student that showed that not only the properties of the surface, but also the properties of the non-interacting surface actually contribute in the description of the binding affinity. And this is the surface that you can see here in pink. Now, inside this this context, I added a third property, that is the number of contact at the interface that has revealed to have a better actually performance in describing binding affinity. As contact at the interface, I mean very easily, the number of contact at the interface are the number of residues that are within a certain distance threshold from each other. After optimization, this distance threshold has, we put this distance threshold at 5.5 angstrom, and we easily count, we very simply count the number of contact within this threshold. So for example, in this little example here, we have 6 of those red contacts. So the total number of contact in this case will be 6. But we also wanted to classify this number of contact based on the chemical-physical properties of those contacts. So for example, we divided the contact based on the charged polar and apolar property of the residues. So in this case, for example, we will have two kind of contacts addressing property one, for example, number of contact between a charged and polar residues, and 4 of the others. So we describe the interface in terms of contact instead of in terms of surface. And then we wanted to check if these properties, so this number of contacts, somehow was correlating with the binding affinity and reporting the performance in terms of person correlation coefficient. Then we tried to train a predictor, and we used a linear regression model in which we train a predictor on those properties. We also used other kind of classification, but the one according to polar, apolar, and charged property of the residues resulted to be the best one. So we perform a linear regression model in which we defined the weight for each of these properties. But we also applied a feature selection criteria, because when you have many features on which you are going to train, you might have a problem of overfitting. So we applied a feature selection method, and also we cross-validated the results that we obtain using a fourfold cross-validation in which you divided your data set in 75% of training and 25% of prediction, and then we repeated this validation 10 times. Another piece of the methods that have been used in this project is, of course, the benchmark. So we used a binding affinity benchmark of protein-protein complexes, in which there are PDB structures available for protein-protein complexes for which the binding affinity has been measured experimentally. And this has resulted to be a very and very nice and also heterogeneous set of data. We have around 100 of complexes with very different properties, so different functional classes, different values of delta G, of barrier surface area, of methods that have been used to measure the binding affinity, and also different values of conformational changes. And as conformational changes, I mean the changes that occur upon binding. So for example, in here in this slide, you can see two complexes. This is the bound form of the complex. If we are going to compare the bound form with the unbound form, so the one here colored, you see that in the first case on the left, so what I call rigid complex, the structures between bound and unbound are basically the same, while for the flexible complex, there is a reorganization. So there is flexibility at the interface, so the proteins to bind have to undergo some conformational changes. Those are defined flexible complexes, and those are more challenging to predict, because indeed there are those conformational changes that can happen. So the benchmark is therefore very heterogeneous. Now there is also an update of this benchmark that we published a few months ago. Now, putting together all those pieces in the methods, I'm going to show you some of the results that we obtain. So the first thing was, of course, checking if there is a correlation between the number of contacts at the interface and the experimental delta G. So you can see here in this plot on the y-axis, there is the number of contacts at the interface. Each of those dots in this plot correspond to a complex of the benchmark. And on the x-axis, there is the experimental delta G. So you can see that there is a kind of correlation that results in an R of minus 0.5. So this means that the more is the number of contacts at the interface, the stronger is the binding, which kind of also makes sense. And comparing this, the performance when correlating a structure of features with experimental delta G, the contact has a correlation of minus 0.5, and the widely used barrier surface area has a correlation of minus 0.3. So there is already an improvement here. But actually, it's very interesting to look at those data also from a different point of view. And this, while when classifying the performance according to the experimental method that has been used to measure the binding affinity, what we observed is that the performance, so the correlation, is it can change a lot. And in particular, in the case of data obtained through inhibition assay and fluorescence, there is basically no correlation between the number of contacts and the experimental binding affinity. As you can see in the plot, the correlation is basically flat. So we decided to keep going with our analysis, but remove those data that might be a source of inaccuracy. So we reduced the data set in a more, using, let's say, a more reliable data. So we proceeded with the 81 cases in particular, and removing inhibition assay and fluorescence data, we got a correlation of minus 0.59 between the total number of contacts and the experimental delta G's. So we wanted to train our predictor on this set of data. So the simplest predictor is, of course, the one that correlates, in which you can predict the binding affinity just using the total number of contacts and, of course, the correlation between the binding affinity that you can predict and the experimental one is 0.59. But since we also divided the number of contacts based on their properties, we train again So we tested different predictors, and we saw that when giving different weight to different compounds, so weighting more some of them, actually you can we obtain a better correlation, that is 0.67. But considering that a couple of years ago there was this nice work in which showed that also the properties of the non-interacting surface contribute in the description of the binding affinity, we decided to add also those informations. So we trained the predictor on many more features, and we got a final correlation of 0.73. So this is the plot between the predicted delta G's that we can predict with this so obtained predictor and the experimental delta G's. So we got a correlation of 0.73. And this is the final predictor formula, in which, as you can see, it has a combination of number of contact and properties of the non-interacting surface. Of course, we also wanted to see how this method compare, how this method is in respect to other approaches. So we wanted to compare this contact-based method with the work in which was actually introducing the non-interacting surface property, a predictor of, from Horton and Lewis that is using the body surface area and has been also retrained on this new set of data. And then we used 105 scoring functions that are reported in CARPPI web server, which is a nice web server that is collecting many potential describing properties of protein-protein complexes. And for completeness, I have to say that those potential that have not been optimized to for the binding affinity problem, they describe properties of protein-protein complexes. And from this analysis, over all those methods, this contact-based one resulted to be the best one. And we analyzed those results on the exact name number of structures. Also, we wanted to check the performance in the case of rigid and flexible complexes, because as I said, rigid are usually easier to predict. And we got a very similar correlation. While usually, in many of the cases, predict the rigid cases, like in this one, it's usually easier than predict the predicting the rigid cases is easier than predicting the flexible ones. So since our web server, our approaches since so far the best performing one to predict binding affinity, we also decided to design a web server for an easy usage of that. So I'm going to provide a quick demo of that. So I should be able to switch. I hope you can see the you can see the interface of our web server called Prodigy. So Prodigy is accessible through www.milu.science.uu.nl/services/prodigy. So in the web server, in the page of Prodigy, so there is the home in which it's possible to upload your job. Then there is a manual page. The manual page, in the manual page, the input format is described, the kind of chain, how you can upload the chains, the parameters that you can use, which are optional, but we give these three options, which is the temperature at which you want the web server to calculate, to predict actually the dissociation constant, because from the delta G, we can also predict the dissociation constant. Then you can give a job ID to your a name to your job. You can also put an email, so you will be notified with a link to your email, so you can close the window and just check the link that you will receive after, and the results will be kept for 2 weeks. Then there is a description of the output that will provide, that I will show you in a while. And there are also instructions to run Prodigy locally. So we made Prodigy as also as a GitHub repository that you can download, install on your computer in case you have many cases to check. Then there is also a method page. So there will be information about the predictor that is indeed the predictor that I just showed you in the slides. There is a plot about the performance, so the predicted delta G and the experimental one that I showed. Through this formula, we are going to also provide the KD, so the dissociation constant. That's why you also will you can personalize the temperature. Then we also provide some information about the performance, so the plot, indeed comparing our contact-based approach with all the others. And some further information about the number of contact. All this information are also, of course, available on the related paper. There is also a page related to the data set. So here you have, we provided a table of all the cases that we used. So this table provides the PDB code, the number of chains, the method that have been used to measure the binding affinity, of course, the experimental binding affinity. Then we provide a list of structural features that we measure, so the number of contact in case for between charged and charged residues, and so on. Also, the properties of the non-interacting surface. Then we have, in addition to the experimental delta G, we also provide the delta G that we actually predict with Prodigy. This table can be downloaded from this link. And also at the end of the page, you can also download an archive file that contains all those PDBs reported here in the table. And they have been, let's say, clean PDB in the sense that cases as that, for example, report double occupancy and this kind of stuff have been cleaned. There is also an example page. I won't go into the details in that because I'm going to show you an example and a reference page. Okay, so if we now go to the home page, there are two options. You can either upload your own PDB file or you can retrieve from the PDB data bank. So for example, if we wanted to upload a file, I'm going to choose this example. So in this PDB file 200B, there is chain A interacting with chain B. So it's fundamental that you put the chain identifier, and it doesn't matter if it's capital or not. Then those parameters are optional, so the default temperature is usually 25 degrees. You can put a job ID, for example, a webinar one, and then you can put your email if you want, and then you can submit the job. Usually Prodigy is really fast. It also depends, of course, to the size of the complex you are analyzing. So as you can see here, the page will first report the binding affinity and the dissociation constant that has been predicted for your complex. So here you have the delta G, and here you have the KD. Then there are some prediction details. So those are the number of contacts that have been used to actually predict the final binding affinity. Then there are the properties, the non-interacting surface properties. Then you have a list of contact at the interface. So in this case, you will have, for example, alanine 934 of chain A is in contact with the leucine 8 of chain B. This table can be downloaded. We also provide a PyMOL script, a .pml, in which there is basically a color code that is going to highlight the interface of your complex. And then you can, of course, download an archive file that will contain tables with all of this information. If we go back, we can also retrieve from the PDB. So for example, I'm going to use this case. Again, it doesn't matter if it's capital or not. So in this specific case, the interactor 1 is made of two proteins, that will be D and E. And the interactor 2 is as chain F. I'm not going to put details in this moment, it's fine. So here is the prediction for the case, so that has been automatically retrieved from the PDB data bank. And as in the other case, you have the prediction of the delta G, of the KD, the contact details, and so on. Finally, I wanted to show you the last option in which you can upload also an archive file. In this case, I will use a digital file that contain it can contain multiple PDB structures. So this can be very useful in the case in which the PDB that you wanted to analyze are many. And for example, they come from a docking simulation. So those are models and you wanted to analyze all of them at the same time. Or also just easily they might be different PDB that you wanted to analyze all at the same time. The only thing that you have to pay attention is that they all have the same chain interactors because you have only one option to put and it has to be the same for all the ensemble. So I'm going to put webinar ensemble. Of course, it will take a bit more time. In this case, I reported 4 PDB structures, but you can also upload more. So in the case you have multiple entries, the result page will look like this. So you will have a list of all the PDB structure that you submitted. So in this case, we will have 4, the predicted delta G and the KD. But if you download the archive file, it will contain detailed information about the number of contacts, the non-interacting surface, the PIMOL script for each of the entries that you uploaded. Okay, so this was the demo of the PDB. So I'm going now back to the presentation. So I hope you can see the presentation now in this moment. Okay. So in conclusion, as a take home message, basically what I show today is that the number and the nature of interface contact in protein-protein complexes, it can be a very simple but also very robust predictor of binding affinity, and so far is the best performing method for binding affinity. We have the web server that you can easily use to check your complexes. We are very open to any kind of question or difficulties about the web server. Remember, you can also download it through GitHub repository. And that's it. So I would like to thank, of course, Alexander Bomban for being part of those nice projects, my colleagues Li Zhuao and Panagiotis to be part of the realization of the web server, and also my colleagues Jörg and Mikael, which are helping in reshaping and making the web server pretty lately. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Anna. That was a very interesting talk. I can see that we've already got some questions coming in, which is great. So I'm now going to open the floor to questions. So if you can see at the side of your GoToWebinar screen, your control panel might look a little bit different than the one shown here. There should be a section that says questions. If you type your question into that box there, we'll be able to see it. And I can pass that on to Anna. So just while those questions are coming in, I'd also like to point out that after the webinar, if you have any further questions that come up, you can look at the BioXcel forums, where there's a particular entry now to discuss this webinar. The link here is on that slide, but you can also get it from the webinar page for this webinar. Okay, so what I'll do with the questions, if the person who has a question has a microphone and is able to ask the question themselves, I will invite the speaker to ask a question directly. You can just unmute your microphone and ask the question. Otherwise, I will ask the question on behalf of the speaker. So the first question is from Ravi. Ravi, are you able to use the microphone to ask the question yourself? Okay, I'm not hearing from Ravi at the moment, so I will ask the question on your behalf, Ravi. Ravi asked, why 5.5 angstroms as the contacts cutoff?
Yes, do you hear me?
Yes, Anna, yep.
Yeah. It has been optimized, so we tried a threshold between 3 angstrom and 2 anti-angstrom. So we very simply picked the one with for which we saw the best correlation.
Okay, thank you. And the next question is from Mauricio. Mauricio, are you able to speak? I wonder if I can. Mauricio, do you want to ask your question directly?
Okay, hello.
Hello, hi.
Hi.
Are you listening to me?
Yes, we can hear you, Mauricio.
I was wondering is there a size limitation between interactor 1 and interactor 2? Did you perform any correlation between size of interactors and binding energy prediction?
Yes, so we didn't see any particular correlation between the size of the interactor itself. Although the benchmark that we use has also big cases, but the biggest were more or less the one resulting from antibodies. So maybe very, very big cases might have an impact, but we didn't see anything relevant from the benchmark that we used.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you. And the next question is from Susan Tsotsos. Susan, are you able to speak directly? Okay, I'll ask the question on Susan's behalf. The question was that she did not understand how Prodigy could be used to predict interactions between two different PDB structures. Are you able to clarify that a bit, please, Anna?
Yes, I think if I am picking correctly, her concern is that you just, instead of clicking, if you have 10 structures, 10 PDB structures that you wanted to predict the binding affinity, instead of clicking and submitting 10 jobs, you can just archive all of them and submit. So it's just a matter of quickness. In particular, we thought about this option in the cases we have. In a specific case, you have models coming from a simulation, MD simulation or docking simulation. So you might have many models that you wanted to analyze, and you don't want to submit one by one, but you might want to see all of them together. So is this answering your question?
I don't know if Susan can answer directly, so let's hope so. If there's a follow-up question, Susan, you can put it into the question box. Thank you. The next question is from Dinler. And Dinley, are you able to unmute to ask the question directly?
Hello. Can you hear me?
Hi. Yes, hi.
So, nice talk. Thank you. I work with peptide ligands, and I wonder if, since Prodigy was not intended for protein ligand complexes, if the predictions will be reliable when you use like a complex with a peptide, let's say with from 9 to 11 residues long.
Yes, thanks for your question. This is a very nice one, actually. So our predictor has been optimized on protein-protein complexes. That's why it doesn't work for protein peptide in the So it is an approach that can be also extended to protein peptide, but definitely it will need optimization. Personally, like what is my first feeling is that definitely the distance threshold has to be decreased in the case of protein ligand or protein small peptide. So no, it has not been optimized for protein ligand, but for proteins.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, thank you very much. The next question was a follow-up from Ravi. He said, ITC, which frankly is one of the best methods of measurement of the binding thermodynamics, clearly has a better correlation with the surface area. He was surprised about that. Do you have any comments on that? Have I interpreted the question correctly?
Yes. So definitely we also, like, if we have to trust a particular method, definitely we trust ITC. The thing that you might have seen a better correlation in that case is also that the distance threshold that we used, this 5.5, has been picked on the overall structures, so also the one including other methods, because we felt pretty comfortable to exclude the cases which we didn't see any signal at all. But in the other, we were not really feeling okay. We just refused to use those data. So in the case of ITC, what I can tell you is that there was so the threshold was slightly different and better for more performing in the case of ITC. But we picked up an overall one. So we also believe that it can definitely be further optimized based on different methods. The reliability of the methods, I think it's one of the biggest issues that we predictors can have in this case. But so this can be the case in which you saw this this correlation for ITC. Has not been optimized exactly on ITC, but on the overall dataset.
Okay, thank you. We had a follow-up question from Mauricio. I don't know if this was answered the first time round. I'll just ask the question on Mauricio's behalf. Mm-hmm. The question was, can the program deal with modified residues such as acetylation and phosphorylation, etc.?
Yes. No. The web server version, no. Online, although the GitHub repository actually, so you can still have the number of contact for that, but we do not provide the non-interacting surface. So this is a feature that will eventually be added soon. But the web server does not take mutated residues.
Okay, and probably related to that, there was a question from somebody who's showing up as an anonymous HTML5 viewer user. The question was, did you try to or plan to adapt it to other complexes, e.g. protein RNA/DNA?
Definitely. There is a work in progress on protein RNA. So, unfortunately, I cannot say much because we have only preliminary results. Hopefully, there will be another webinar at some point about protein RNA. But yes, sure. We are planning to extend it.
Okay, that's great. Let us know when it's ready, and we will run that webinar.
Okay.
The next question is from Rodrigo. Rodrigo, do you want to ask your question directly? So I don't know if Rodrigo can speak. So the question was, can this tool be used to predict the structure of protein-protein complexes? If so, how reliable are the resulting structures?
So I suppose he means a kind of dogging question. So predicting the structure. So this predictor works on, you must have already the structure. Although it might be also just a model, so not necessarily is the final structure, it can work on that. I don't know how reliable can be on that one, but it is not used so far to predict the structure itself, starting from the two separate protein. You must have already the bound form. Surely it can be tried to be used to scoring. So it can be used together with other assessment to see actually if a model is representing of a real structure, a native-like model, native-like structure. And this is one of the other work in progress. Is it this answering to his question?
I hope so. Yes, Rodrigo, if you have a follow-up, you can type it into the box. Okay, he says yes, thanks. That answers the question, so that's
okay.
Great. And one more question that we have here. Martin Kloster Jesperson, would you like to ask the question directly?
Yeah, so can you hear me?
Yes, hi, Martin, hi.
Hi. So I just wondered, you, as far as I understood, that you used all sorts of contexts, so you don't focus on only specific, so there could be backbone contexts, right?
Yes, exactly, yes. Okay. A heavy atoms. The contacts are calculated on the heavy atoms, so no hydrogens.
Okay. So you haven't really tried to be more specific on which type of interaction you look at, or when you define an interaction?
Yes, so we tried atomic-atomic contact and residue-residue contact. In this case, those are residue-residue. It means that two residues are defined in contact if any of the atom, any of the heavy atom, is within the distance threshold, because we saw that at residue level the performance was a bit better than atomic level. That's why we define the property on the residue, not on the atom. So as long as any of the atom are in contact, the two residues are in contact, so we classify those charged and polar and apolar residues on the residue, not on the atoms that are in contacting, because we choose to represent the contact as residue level.
Okay. Cool. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Martin. And okay, I think that was the last question that I have in my list of questions in the question box. Does anyone have any other questions or comments for Anna just now? If so, you can type them into the question box. If not, if something occurs to you later, you can follow the link on the slide, or go through our website, and you can leave a question on our forums, and we will follow it up there. So if we have no further questions just now, I would like to thank Anna once again for a very interesting talk, and thank you also to all of you for your interesting questions at the end. I hope you found this webinar interesting, and I would encourage you, if this is your area of work, please do join our interest group so that you can keep in touch with other things going on in this area. Thank you all very much, and I will speak to you all again soon, hopefully.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Anna. Bye.